Just a quick bit of kind of 50,000 feet kind of view of where we are. Things used to be simple. We had a few opportunities, a few choices to make when it came to how we talk to our audiences. Last kind of 5-10 years or so, things have got slightly more complicated. We've got lots more choices, lots more opportunities to talk to our people, lots more ways in which we can go about doing that. Whereas it used to be one thing that we had, we now have 1 million. Whereas we used to know what we were talking about, nowadays we're not quite so sure. So the world has changed quite significantly. Just taking social, and this is very much about a social media kind of event. So just taking social, this is just a kind of a cloud around who the players within that social scape are. And you can just see in a very short space of time, it's become very, very complicated. Lots and lots of technologies and lots of players. Getting money from our clients used to be easy. We just used to talk to them. Nowadays, it's a lot harder to find where that money is and to find how to get that money. So these are kind of the challenges we face. So as marketeers and as advertisers, whereas our job used to be simple, nowadays it's a lot more akin to this kind of scenario. Some rocket science in case, yeah, you get it. So things, you know, have got a lot more complicated, and that's something that we really need to be aware of. And if you were to draw out on a single whiteboard the general kind of communication plans of a company with their marketing and their advertising and their communication plan with your client, it's probably going to look something like this, which is pretty much incomprehensible. You can't really get your hands around it and get a feeling for who it is that I'm talking to and what am I trying to say to them. And that really is the crux of it, I guess. It's going to drive us crazy at some point. So we need to start looking at how we kind of cut through this and kind of cut through the, you know, the crazy kind of situation that we're in. Now, just sitting here the last couple of days and listening to the presentations that are going on, there are so many choices, and we really need to get back to what is at the heart of everything that we do. So, question for today is, you know, looking at that huge kind of media exposure that we now offer people, what have we forgotten within this mix? And I think it's pretty simple. We've forgotten that, at the end of the day, it's people that buy products. And that's really what audience targeting and behavioural targeting is about. It's about the fact that people buy products. So it's not technology, it's not channels, it's not fads, it's not gimmicks, it's not anything else. It's people that buy products. So the key message is, if you place people at the heart of what you do and utilise the opportunities in terms of how you talk to them and the way in which you talk to them, if you utilise that, focusing on the fact it's people at the heart of it, you're going to get a lot more success, because you focus on the fact that people buy products. Does that kind of make sense? If it doesn't, I'm kind of stuck, because that's the whole premise of what I'm talking about. So anybody nodding or not nodding at that point, I think it's probably worth going to a different workshop. Okay, so this audience targeting thing, what is it? Just a quick video, just kind of outlines from our company point of view kind of where audience targeting and where it's going to be going. So.
Imagine, if you will, sitting down to your morning coffee, turning on your home computer to read the day's newspaper. Well, it's not as far-fetched as it may seem.
17 stories up in his fashionable North Beach apartment, Richard Halloran is calling a local number that will connect him with a computer in Columbus, Ohio. These editors are programming today's copy of the paper into that same Ohio computer. Sure. When the telephone connection between these two terminals is made, the newest form of electronic journalism lights up Mr. Halloran's television with just about everything the Examiner prints in its regular edition.
This is an experiment. We're trying to figure out what it's going to mean to us as editors and reporters and what it means to the home user.
Well, it takes over 2 hours to receive the entire text of the newspaper over the phone, and with an hourly use charge of $5, the new telepaper won't be much competition for the 20-cent street edition.
Engineers now predict the day will come when we get all our newspapers and magazines by home computer.
Sorry about the sales bit at the end, but and apologies that it was quite kind of American focused, but it, so we're an American company, and that's quite an old video, so it kind of played to the American market at that point. But the point from that is behavioural targeting, audience targeting, is something that's becoming intrinsic to what we do as a business. It must be a critical part of our strategy from a marketing sense, because it's about reaching people, and as we said before, people buy products. But it's also about people reaching people when they're in the right frame of mind. And the message from that video really is, it's a bit kind of a throwaway comment that behavioural targeting, audience targeting will be bigger than search in 2020. But if you think about kind of what that means, it's saying that if you're so in tune with the people that you're interacting with and the people that are interacting with specific types of content that are relevant to you, then in theory, you should be delivering a message to them when in their conscious and their subconscious, they're thinking, I'm thinking about this product, I'm interested in that product. At that point, they don't actually need to search and go and find something because you're delivering that message to them at that point. Now, that's quite a kind of, that'd be nice to happen kind of thing. But if you think about kind of the mechanics of that and you think about the underlying kind of rules of that, I think that's a very true statement, that if you use enough data, you leverage it in the right way, and you talk to people in the right manner, and you bring in things like dynamic creative and optimization of where you talk to people, then you can deliver the message at that moment in time when they're thinking about it, and they won't need to then go and search for it. So that's kind of the underlying thing. So where are we now? It looks like you've got all the data. What's the hold up? I think that's one of the biggest frustrations, I think, of lots of marketers. I'm not a marketer, so please tell me if I'm wrong, but I think one of the biggest frustrations is you see this big kind of pool of data that you have as a business, your website, your offline data, your point of sale material, your relationships with your kind of third-party providers. You've got so much data there, you've got no idea how to kind of leverage that, and you try different things. And the issue perhaps you get from the top down is that people will say to you, well, you've got all this data, there's behavioural targeting out there, what's the problem? Why aren't you making it more of a success of it? And I think that's really where companies that are now in this space are really trying to look at that and address those kind of issues and make life easier in terms of understanding the data you have and how you leverage that. I think with that brings certain kind of challenges, and I'll get onto those in a minute. Situational awareness. This is about being aware of what it is that you're actually using. So the term behavioural targeting, which my boss claims we invented back in 99, that phrase, but anyway, it's very broad. It's a very broad statement. And there are lots of people that will tell you they do behavioural targeting or they provide behavioural targeting services. And I think one of the challenges for most people in this room is understanding what it is they're actually buying. Just to give you an idea, here is a brand over here, and here's their client right over there. And that's all the people in the marketing kind of provision space, whether they be agencies, whether they be data providers, data aggregators, networks, etc., that can influence your behavioural message to your client. And you can see from that, or it's your behavioural message to your customer, sorry, you can see from that it's a hugely complicated space. So you need to understand what it is you're trying to do within that space. And I'm not trying to scare you off here saying, good Lord, don't try behavioural targeting because look, it is so complicated. You can cut through that as long as you follow some core principles. And that's really what we're going to hopefully kind of get you to think about today and start interacting with today. So what are the core principles of what I'm supposed to be doing here? And really to highlight this point, a list of items up there. Can anybody tell me what those items create or what they could create when they're combined? Car, there you go. So glad someone got it. That's a list of items that you would use to make a car. In the same way that that could be a list of data points and a list of providers, a list of elements that you would plug into a behavioural targeting solution. And this is the challenge of the market is you can use those items and you can create that, which is a car. It's functional, it does exactly what it's supposed to do, the quality, etc., is what it is. But you could also use the exact same items to create one of those. And that's really is the biggest challenge. The difference between those two items is vast. One's a high-end premium 4x4, revered around the world as being pretty much the best. The top one is one that's, you know, people laugh at because it's a bit of a joke in terms of its quality and its styling, etc. But the core elements that you use to build it are exactly the same. There is no difference. They all use those same elements. So it's what you do with what you have that matters. And it's the same that applies for behavioural targeting or an audience targeting. It's what you have that matters. And what you need to do is to make sure that you're using what you have in a way that gets the best result, that delivers you a Range Rover rather than a Lada. Not that Ladas are bad, anybody that's got one. Okay, so just going to outline what we believe are the core fundamental things you should be thinking about when you're looking to create behavioural audience-based messaging to users. What are the kind of building blocks that you use? It's a bit of a giveaway. And then from that, we're going to just run through some examples. I'm going to get you in tables to kind of start thinking about if I'm a certain advertiser, and I'll give you some examples, what kind of data would I have, and potentially what can I do with that data? And then we'll just go around the room and we'll get people to kind of give us their thoughts on how potentially they would use the data that they think they can get hold of to create what they want to try and achieve. So we would argue there's three core kind of foundation elements, building blocks of behavioural targeting. The first one is interest. So this is really saying, do I have data that is relevant to the product that I'm looking to push to them? So whether this be you working with a publisher, for example, and they have particular type of content that the people who are going to be interested in your product would be reading. Or do I have data points on these people that show an interest in the product that I have? Product review pages or blog postings, etc. But data that says, I'm interested in what it is that you have. That's a crucial bit, because if they're not interested in your product, then there's no point talking to them. You talk to them through a completely different kind of method, which is about trying to get them interested. And you know, it's much, much further up the funnel. So you need that level of interest. You need the right data that shows they're interested in what it is you're trying to do. The second most important is intent. Some people would call it intent frequency. So it's how many times they're engaging with the content that you've said is the content of interest. Are they engaging with it enough times to show a level of intent that you want? Now, that level of intent can be, it doesn't have to be at the point of buying. It can be right at the start of the funnel, the purchase funnel. But make sure you're aware of what level of intent you think is relevant and right associated with the right kind of content, the right level of interest. Because if you want someone who you want right at the bottom of the funnel who's about to buy a car, for argument's sake, there's no point serving a message to a person who's read one product review about your product. Then you've read 5 or 6 or 7 product reviews and shown that level of intent to say they're interested, not just interested, but they actually have a passion, an intent to do something. So you can really leverage behavioural targeting right through the very simple early stages, right through to the point where they're going to buy. But as long as you're aware of what it is you're trying to do with that intent at that moment in time, it can be very, very powerful. And crucially, both of those won't work without the final bit, which is, sorry, I'm just going to grab some water as he walks in front of the screen, is recency. If you have great interest data around the right type of interest, and you have the right level of intent, people are engaging often enough, they must have done that in a recency window, a period of time in history that actually suits the product you're trying to sell. And I use this as an example later, so I'm probably going to give the game away, but if you're Apple selling iPods, and you say, great, I've got people who are reading content around iPod product reviews and MP3 product reviews, isn't that fantastic? They're reading about the kind of thing that shows they're interested in my product. And I've picked out people that have done it at least 5 times. It's brilliant. So they're reading lots and lots of content around MP3 product reviews. Isn't that genius? But if they've done it in the last year, that's no good. Because if you're buying an iPod, you make a decision probably in a week or 2 weeks about whether you're going to buy it or not. So there's no point having data that sits over a year. You need it in a recency window that actually matches the product. So in that instance, you'd say anyone who's read 4 or 5 product reviews on MP3s, iPods, etc. So interest and intent, but in the last 3 days, because then it shows that they're looking at that content in a time window that suggests they're in market for the product you're looking to push them. Does that make sense? Yeah? Good. Is that something you've kind of thought about before, come across before? More than nodding heads, please. Has anybody kind of had anything different to that or had any different experiences to that at all? Good. We like that. We'll move on then. So that's great. That's the foundation, the building blocks of the audience that you create. And you can tailor this to whatever audience you need. You use the right type of interest, the right level of intent, the right level of recency to create the audience that you need. And say it's very, very flexible from quite simple one-touch retargeting where you might have one interaction with them, but that's all you need at that point, right through to people who are very explicitly showing that they're about to buy your product and you want to deliver a message to them. So we would say there's three kind of key types of data that you should be looking at. The first one is hard data. So what are people telling me about themselves? So what are they explicitly saying? I am a 34-year-old male. I am interested in PlayStations. I'm looking to buy a car. Hard physical data, whether that comes from a social environment where they interact with you and they tell you data about themselves, whether it comes from traditional kind of demographic data that you have, it's physical hard data that you know explicitly about that person. You then have soft data, the card toy kind of gives it away. And this is more of a I can assume kind of data. So you visit a travel website, you're probably interested in travel. You go to websites about PlayStations, you're probably interested in PlayStations. That kind of content is a direct kind of one-to-one correlation between what you're doing and therefore what your interest is. And the third type of data, and I think probably the most powerful kind of data, and that's a Salvador Dali picture, and you'll see why in a minute, is implied data. So what does it actually mean, this data that I have? Or what does it mean when someone does something? What does it mean? Examples of this are, and I'm just picking off online examples because it's easier to kind of get your head around. If I go to a car review site and I look for MPVs, so the Ford S-Max or the Ford C-Max kind of car, you can imply from that that I'm probably a family, because you don't necessarily buy that type of car unless you have a family. So it's taking those kind of data points that aren't a direct, I've been to a travel site, therefore I am. It's what's the implication of my action? What does it mean? And you can get a lot more out of the implied kind of data, because you can start making assumptions about what things mean. And you then start adding the frequency and the recency of that as well. And you can build up really powerful kind of audiences based off very broad, what initially look like fairly invaluable data sets that suddenly become very valuable by the nature of what they mean, or what the implication of what they mean is. So these are kind of the three core types of data that you should try, or we believe you should try and segment your audiences into. So you can start getting a handle around what do I actually have. And then once you've got that, you can then start working on how you leverage it. So to your point about how do we learn, you know, just understand your data is the first question, or the first point to learn, because once you understand what you've got, you can do a lot more with it. So this is where you need to get a bit more interactive. So in tables, just thinking about what I've said in terms of building blocks and in terms of types of data, I want you all to pretend you're going to be Audi for a moment. There's no one from Audi here, is there? Good, so you haven't got a head start. So put yourself in the mindset of an Audi marketeer. You're going to run a campaign, and your campaign objective very much is that this is people who are fairly near the bottom of the, fairly near the final point of the purchase funnel. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to get them to come in. You know, they're thinking about premium cars. You want to get them to come in and explicitly think about Audi. So just have a think and a chat amongst yourselves when your table is about, okay, if I'm working with web partners, if I have data myself that I can use, what would I do with that data? How would I build that data out? What kind of things would I try and do with that data to create an audience of people that are right for my product? Does that make sense? Any questions on that before I start? Okay, you'll need to talk to each other at this point. What kind of data? Where that data? Everybody, I'm just aware that I don't want to take up all your time. So, okay, interesting going around and listening to you talk. I purposely didn't give you the purpose of what you're trying to achieve from the start. I just wanted to see how you kind of started talking about what it was and what was going on. The idea was to get you thinking more about data, I guess, and thinking about what types of data actually do we have access to, and how can we use that data and leverage that data. I think some of the big issues are that historically people think in a very linear sense. If I'm Audi, I must run on a car site, or I must have data from people that told me they're interested, so historical data. But actually trying to think more about, you know, what's the profile of who I'm trying to reach? What would their interests be? What data can I use to influence that? So does anybody want to kind of give their thoughts on the conversation around their table? Kind of what they start thinking about and where they got to? There isn't a right or wrong answer, so don't think that it's a test. There isn't marks for...
Yeah, I'd like to share, one of the things we first agreed...
One of the first things that we agreed on is that, you know, the best precursor to the future is the behavior you demonstrated in the past. And that's what's so great about, you know, behavioral targeting. You know, we started talking about, you know, one of the things is, you know, is intent. As you said earlier, there has to be, in interest. You know, so you sort of want to kind of look around and say, you know, what is the behavior that demonstrates some type of interest? So if it's somebody that's looking at, you know, a consumer report on automobiles, you know, so they're starting to look at, you know, new automobiles, et cetera. But we also want to be able to talk to a consumer based on the ability to act on a behavior. So, you know, one of the things, I don't know if you have it here in Europe, but in the U.S., it's called Kelley Blue Book.
Yep.
Gives you the value of a used car, which, you know, demonstrates a behavior, you know, potentially the intent to sell a car. So now you've got interest, you know, you're looking at magazines, you're looking potentially at the intent to do something. And then, you know, the other part of it was implications and correlations. And so consumers, you know, that are potentially looking at action sports and also, performance-related type activities, you know, that is associated with, you know, with the type of car that Audi is. So you take those three things and draw them correlation together, and you start picking out where you want to advertise and send your communications.
Yep, exactly right. So you've picked off different types of data there. You said some of that data is either hard or soft. You've been to Kelly Blue Book, which is equivalent to Parker's in the UK or Glasses Guy. I'm not sure what the equivalent in Germany would be. But it's saying there is, you know, hard and soft data there, which is I've done a one-to-one action. So there is a level of intent there. But also, my broader interest, my broader profile is I'm interested in action sports. So that would suggest I'm a type of character that would be right for a particular type of product. So just starting to, you know, get your head around the fact there are lots of data sets. Dividing that data up at the first point is crucial. Anyone else kind of have different or similar thoughts?
Okay, I mean, we did a similar thing working through what data would be hard, what would be soft, and what would be implied. And I think many of the points were made just then. But another thought we had was that Audi is, and this talks to how the companies organize themselves internally. Audi is part of a larger group, so it's a Volkswagen and Audi group. And they just wondered whether at different stages in a person's life, they're more likely to buy different cars from that particular group. So you may go from a Seat to a Volkswagen to a Skoda, for example, and whether the company is able to share that data within the various groups to say, well, this guy bought a Seat when he was aged 25 or something. We now want to move him onto a Volkswagen or move him onto the Audi. Therefore, and it's a question of whether companies are very well set up to be able to share that data that they hold in different divisions about a particular consumer. Yep. And I would suggest that they're companies are not great at doing that.
But what a great, if they were, what a great story to say, okay, we have people that historically have bought Seat, and now it's time to move on to VW. They've already got a brand affinity with VAG. They've bought a Seat, but it's still a VAG product. So if you take that data and you say, okay, what's the perfect, let's make some profiles for each of the VW range. So we'll have a family profile and a sports enthusiast profile and a someone that likes speed and someone that likes technology. And we can leverage the fact that we already know, so one of our data sets, hard data set, is they're already a customer. But then when we re-message them, we can reach them for that. We know they're a customer. And subsequently, we build in more data that means we're delivering the right message to them, which is, here's a Golf GTI. Here's a diesel because I'm interested in the environment. Here's a MPV because I'm a family. And you start leveraging different data points that are, in their own instance, completely separate from each other to start delivering a message, the right kind of message to the right kind of people, to the people that are going to buy a product. So.
I was just going to explore the area of implied, because we talked a bit about that, and whether there's a way of looking at somebody's lifestyle changes. You know, we talked about families, and you have kids. Maybe that means you're going to buy a new car and that sort of thing. But it was an interesting point. Sort of halfway through, we realized what we had to do is assume this data was going to be available, because we don't know enough about it.
Absolutely.
And that worries me, personally. We didn't talk about this, but it goes right back to the beginning of email, when you got opt-in and opt-out. So you assume if you get an opt-in, that means somebody's opt-in.
Yep.
But it didn't mean they opted in. It meant that somebody somewhere had managed to persuade them to opt-in when they didn't know they'd opted in.
Yep.
And so it worries me about the whole thing about data quality, and I think that was made at the beginning by Monster. That if you can be caught in dangerous advertising practices if you don't know where your data's coming from.
I think there's two messages you're getting there. One is privacy, which I will touch on at the end. Privacy is massively important, and it's growing as an issue. So it's something that, as an industry and as a user of these technologies, it's something we need to be aware of. I think the other message there, and I think is a critical one, again, parental advisory, shit in, shit out kind of philosophy. You know, you need to be sure of the data you're using, because if you put bad data in, you're going to get a bad result out of it. And I think I alluded to earlier, you know, it comes down to who you're working with, not necessarily from a technology point of view, but if your data that you're drawing is coming from sources that you're not comfortable with. And I know we're at a social media conference, but is Twitter a good source of explicit data? It's a question. If it isn't, then you need to put safeguards in place and understand
the processes you have to go through to make sure that you're comfortable with the use of that data. Now, it's not to say don't use it. It just might be that you, in that instance, put greater safeguards on the way in which you use that data. Whereas if you're working with publisher partners, FAZ or Hansford, anybody along those lines, then you're pretty assured of that data. You can be a lot more comfortable with its robustness and its security. So it's, you know, this isn't an easy win for marketers. It's not going to make your lives so much easier and change everything for you. It's something you have to work out. And we said about social media, you need to have people in place to work on it. I'm not saying go out and employ loads of people, behavioural specialists in your business, but you do need to be aware of what you're doing. It's not just it's not the magic kind of bullet. So it's a very valid point. Privacy is a big thing. I will quickly touch on that at the end, if that's all right. But it leads through, and I hope you're going to answer this point, but what are some of the challenges that you kind of experienced?
I am trying to decide whether to buy an Audi XYZ or a BMW. So it's, you can capture that information as Audi, and that's a fantastically exciting piece of data because someone is explicitly going, I want to buy a car. But because it's a social media process, you can't necessarily identify who they are. Particularly, you can't match it back to your existing data sets of customers and databases that you've got because they've posted under whatever name. So although there's the tantalizing excitement of somebody explicitly entering a decision process to buy and telling the world that's what they're doing, how to then lever that and access it can be a very big challenge.
Absolutely right. And again, it comes back to what I said right at the start, is understand the data you have. In terms of knowing users from piece of data to piece of data, one of the crucial applications or crucial foundations of any good behavioural technology is that the cookie is unique to the provider of the cookie rather than to each individual publication. So you can actually start seeing, and you've got one person that carries a cookie and they carry all the data sets within that, or their cookies linked to each of those data sets. So you can start saying someone who's, as long as your cookie's being dropped on that blog, then you can capture the fact that they've been on that blog and they've also been to site A, site B, site C. And that's fundamental to the technological sense of leveraging that data. And I'm not an expert in that field in any way, shape or form. We have people that do that very successfully for us. But I mean, that's the fundamental. Without that, you don't have a product, because if you don't have the visibility between the data, then you can't leverage it. But to your point about how, you know, what's the value of that data, and how do you make that data work for you? Is it the right kind of data to use? That comes back to the question that was raised earlier: is, you know, how do I build my audiences? And that, you know, that's not a quick answer. You really do need to work at that and say, what is the value of X versus Y? And that's only something you can do through building this, you know, building these up and trying them out, basically, and kind of learning from that and working with people that have experience in those areas to give you advice, whether it be consultancy firms, technology firms, or kind of publishing partners. Anyone else have any kind of thoughts on that? Deathly silence. I'm aware of time. I did bring some other examples. I didn't know how long we'd spend on that. So we were going to run through similar kind of examples for iPod, but I kind of gave that one away. We're going to run through some for Europe Car. Europe Car is a strange one. It's how do you behaviorally target someone who's interested in a hire car? It's not an easy process. Their purchase window, their purchase in-market window, that's the word I'm looking for, is really, really short. When you buy a holiday, you hire a car at the same time, generally. But it can still be leveraged in a very successful way. So Europe Car, their data set could be people that are, or they could partner with holiday firms, they could partner with holiday insurance providers, etc. And as long as they keep their recency window really short, perhaps even 24 hours, then they're capturing people in a very kind of in-market nature. They can work with people that access that kind of data. So there's lots of ways in which you can kind of leverage that. And we're going to do the same with Pampers. So a great example, if I said to you, okay, build an audience for Pampers, you'd say, yeah, great, anyone that's been to mumsnet.com, etc. That's great, because people that are going to Mumsnet are looking at baby things. They're probably going to be interested in buying Pampers. But this is where things like the intent element come in really, really importantly, because if you're Pampers and you target anybody that's been to Mumsnet, you're going to be targeting lots of grandmothers and grandfathers that go in there to look at Mumsnet, because that's where my daughter's going to go to look at what she's going to be looking at, and I want to look at there for a gift idea. So things like, how often do they go to Mumsnet? What other things do they do alongside going to Mumsnet that help you define the Mumsnet audience and the audience you therefore want to target for Pampers into more than just everybody, but actually into who are the mothers within this kind of environment? So it's just, and some of it, sometimes it's really, really simple, and you can just say, they've been to Mumsnet at least 5 times, perfect. That means there must be a mother over a grandmother, because grandmothers probably wouldn't go there that often. Something as simple as that is a form of behavioural targeting, audience targeting. It's going to define your audience for you. Or you can mix it in with other data. So it's just starting to get your head around that kind of broader sense. Does anybody have any questions about how you actually physically go about doing this? I'm aware I'm just kind of skipping through and trying to give you the broad kind of highlights.
But let's say I'm a mum, something needs to happen, but let's say that. So I'm going to such a mum's website.
Yep.
And I have some behavior there, I go back and forth. Maybe I'm an adventurous mum, so I'm also going to a climbing website. Whatever, you know, can you actually, how do you combine that data?
Okay, so this comes, I guess, down to who are the players within the industry. And I guess it can be broken down into three key ways in which you go about doing that. And one is kind of one subdivided into two. I'm making this more complicated than it needs to be. But in a traditional sense, you can work with your agency. So your agency will drop spotlight, floodlight tagging, et cetera, retargeting tags as part of any campaign they run for you to monitor the success or otherwise of your campaign. They can be used in a relatively simple sense to kind of do intelligent retargeting. So retargeting people because they've been to your website, but adding in an element of recency, frequency, et cetera. So that's a really simple way of looking at it. Most kind of media networks now have forms of solutions that can offer this. So they're taking technology and they're leveraging that technology to understand the interaction with the sites that they manage, and also in some instances your site, and then you can start using that data. But it's about working with those people. So you need to go to that media network and say, here's my campaign brief, I've defined my audience, work with me to leverage the data you have to create the audience that fits the profile that I want to reach. But that's often about their data rather than your data at that point. And the third way is to choose a technology partner, such as Audience Science. Sorry, joking. Work with a technology partner that can span across all of those. And there's others. Wonderloop is one. There's Takoda is part of AOL. They'll help you out with the same kind of thing. But working with a technology partner that kind of sits as, a gateway between that. And they can work with media. So they can help you access the right kind of media, whether that's their own publisher partners, whether that's networks, whether that's exchanges, DSPs, etc. The world that means nothing to me. But they can access media, but at the same time, they can help you leverage your data. So, for example, and I only talk about audience science because I know it, but for audience science, we can bring in syndicated partner data that we have from publishers that we work with. We can bring in we can drop our cookies on your site. We can bring in all your site data. So all the interaction that happens on your site. But also we can cookie match against any offline data you have. So if you have catalog use data or offline records, point of sale material, we have ways in which we can link that data to a cookie and put it into an online environment. You could work with marketing services providers. So big traditional kind of direct mail kind of providers of financial information or mosaic data, etc. There's ways in which you can start mapping that in.
Given the sort of the recent browsers and the ability to adapt and modify your cookie settings, mm-hmm. how many people are actually able to serve up a cookie,
yep.
and they've not fiddled about with their settings to say, I don't want cookies served up, I don't want any tracking going on?
Yep, good question. And there's this kind of a sub-element to that as well, which is cookie deletion as well. So not just people that are blocking them, but people deleting them. Clearly, it's something that affects what you can do. It's quite a simple answer, I guess. Three elements. I say it's a simple answer. There's now three elements to it. But if people don't want to be tracked, don't track them. So this technology is about reaching people based on data. If people don't want you to have their data, then that's their absolute God-given right. So there's no way in which, at that point, you should be forcing that upon them. And that's fine. Secondly, I think the popularity of kind of cookie deletion to a degree, but more so that kind of browser setting, actually isn't as popular as people think. Most people generally don't care. They assume, and we talk a lot about, in the privacy space, we talk about a lot about value exchange. And we say that people go to sites and they get something for free. And in exchange, they assume they're going to be commercialized in some way. They're going to be served advertising, and there's ways in which that advertising is going to be enhanced to make the message more relevant so they can charge more for it. That's a fair value exchange between you as a user and the site you go to. That's a big part of the privacy debate, is how much value exchange is there and what level of kind of notice and choice should you give consumers. But that straw poll on the street, most people probably don't actually really worry that much about.
When you say most, do you mean 95% or 80% or 51%?
Yeah,
That's a really hard one to answer, because you can do studies and you can ask people, but so much is in the semantics of what you're asking. If you walked up to someone in the street and say to them, do you want to be tracked online? Everyone's going to say no. But I didn't bring it with me today. But there was a study by a law firm called Olswang in partnership with the IAB in the UK. And they addressed this point. They went up to people in the street and said, do you want to be tracked? And everybody said no, because it's a natural human reaction to say no. They then said, but okay, the data that is used to track you, the data that's used to serve your behavioural targeting ads, there's less data. It's less data than you give to Facebook, for example. So you give more information to something you're very comfortable with. Are you happy with behavioural targeting? And the increase in happiness went, I think, from initially from 24% who are happy with behavioural targeting to about 50%. They then said, having realised that actually the data you give up is less than you give to Facebook, you also get control of it. You can opt out at any point. You can go to, it's within privacy policies of sites. There's institutions like the IAB set up to deal with this. So you have control over your data. If you don't want to be tracked, it can be turned off. So why are you comfortable with behavioural targeting? And the popularity or the happiness with it increased to 74%. So we went from 24% through 50% up to 74%. Now, that's just a one kind of example, one kind of survey that talks about that subject. It's really hard to understand physically. I can't give you a number because I don't know. And without asking everybody in the world, I'd never know. But I suppose the key part to that is we run a lot of behavioural targeting. We collect about 3 billion behaviours a day. We run hundreds and thousands of campaigns. It only works because we have that data. So I suppose one of the key things is you have as much data as you have. As long as you have the permission to use that data, whether it be opt-in through PII data or whether it be this kind of value exchange element, as long as you have enough data, you're going to target the people you have. As I said earlier, you're never going to use this as your entire marketing campaign. You're always going to be doing other things as well. So as much as you have, you use, because it's valuable. And if that's 10% or 90%, it not becomes irrelevant, but it's less of an issue at that point.
Depending on where they are in the buying cycle, you would want to have a different message. Having those dynamic banners running depending on cookie can be fairly tricky.
Can be very tricky, yeah. So, it's and costly, yeah. So there are, just to kind of build on that question a bit, for those who don't know, there are technologies out there called dynamic ad providers, TerraScent, Tumery. I think TerraScent have just been bought by Google, and people like Struck, Criteo, names you may have heard of, and they take cookie data and they serve a placeholder ad, so a kind of a basic ad, and the content within that ad is then affected and altered by the knowledge of that particular user. So the idea is it's supposed to be an ad that's individual to the user rather than just a generic ad. It is, or can be costly. You pay a percentage fee. We've got 5 minutes, just everybody aware. Just thought I'd share that. You do pay...
5 minutes.
Yeah, 5 minutes, just so you know. It is expensive, but it can prove to be very, very successful. We ran some trials in the US. We saw a 400% increase in response. It's very, very effective, but it's quite a fine art. It's not something that you enter lightly. The alternative is about just defining audiences. And you say, I have a vertical value. And someone spoke earlier about T people, a kind of similar kind of process. I have a vertical value, which is people interested in Audi. And then I can subdivide that based on characteristics that are appropriate to the model. So families, sports enthusiasts, technology enthusiasts, high net worth individuals, etc. That's a far more specific kind of, I'm going to serve a piece of creative to these people and a piece of creative to these people, piece of creative to these people. It's less flexible, but certainly it's not just I'm going to serve you an Audi ad. I'm going to serve you an Audi ad that's interesting because it's family-based or sports-based. So you can, that's the idea, is you start working on that. So there is a creative element to that in terms of additional creative types. Or you can go the full extreme and just go for the kind of TerraScent dynamic creative. I think that's where we're kind of moving towards is how does that play out and how do we get kind of more involved in that. I've got to wrap up now because they've opened the doors, which is my cue. I was going to talk about response. I was going to talk about ROI, all the things you probably want to hear about. I'm happy to talk to you about those independently afterwards. I'm happy to, I'll leave my presentation behind. There's a study called Natural Born Clickers by Starcom, which is definitely worth a read. It talks about who actually clicks on ads. And I think it's 6% of the population generate 50% of clicks on ads, and those 6% are low-income, middle-aged men. Natural-born clickers is the study. It also says that the three biggest age groups that click on social media ads are under 25, and something like 50,
56%, I think, of all ads generated on social media sites are under 17-year-olds. So I think someone said yesterday, if you're using social media, don't use it for clicks, because that's not, you're getting the wrong people clicking. But the point is, I can talk about more about that if you want to, kind of aside of that. I just want to leave you with what I started with. People buy products. Let's not forget the person in the middle. You know, everything else is great. It's a great way of talking to them, but we need to place people back at the heart of what we do. So thank you very much.